Everybody will be happy over there. I remember I used to say that in order to be happy over there, you have to be happy down here. Do we have some happy folk in the Lord's church down here? Amen. So if you're happy here, you'll be happy there. Certainly God has been good to us. Amen. We indeed thankful to the Lord for another opportunity to worship him in spirit and in truth, and to make our calling and election sure. Many lay down on last night and they didn't get up this morning. And God saw fit to touch you with the finger of love and started you on your way today. And for that, we should be thankful to live out what God has put in and to worship the Lord in spirit. We also worship him in truth. To those who are here as guests this morning, we want you to know that we are happy that you are here today. And we hope, trust, and pray, especially those who may not share with us our like precious faith, that you will come again after having heard something to encourage you to dig deeper into God's book, the Bible, and to come and to worship him in spirit and in truth, and to be a part of the Lord's, being a part of the Lord's church. Brother Hawkins is preaching at Hawthorne this morning. He was called to speak over there, and we want to pray for him that God would be with him in his message on this morning. I want to go back to the text that I preached the last time that I was here. I didn't get all that, get it all. And sometime you have to do a part two. And I want to go back to Matthew 16, right? And pick up verses 13 through 18. And as you know, Jesus came into the coast or the region of Caesarea Philippi. He asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, some are always saying, aren't they? Some say, what? John the Baptist. Some say, some Elijah, and others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona. Why? For flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that thou art Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." The church built by Christ. And this will have a bent to leadership as we talk today. And I want to talk today about organization and autonomy. And there are many churches in our world, but there's only one church built by Christ. Amen? And conceptualized by God, built by Jesus, which compromises the believers of Christ, who are, as we have said, are his foot soldiers on earth trying to make heaven their home. We don't build the church that we want. The church of Christ is not McDonald's or where you can have it, a Burger King, where you can have it your way. Is that right? We build upon and build up the church Christ promised to build and indeed did build. Now, I'm going to go over some things that someone say, "Well, I know all this." Well, everybody doesn't know what you know. And we should not assume that everybody understands the leadership of the church. Some of us have been in the church 40 years, 50 years, or some have only been in 4 months. Some have only been in 4 years and may not have an understanding of the leadership that God wants in the church. And so these scriptures and sermons like these are paramount in understanding how the church has been built and organized. Thereby, we can continue to follow his word and the church keeps on going and operating as Jesus intended for it to operate. Amen? So the church of Christ, or the church that Jesus built, the church of Christ, is an organized, not an unorganized, but it is an organized body of believers in Christ whose leadership, completely organized, would look like a church that has elders and deacons, evangelists, teachers, and members in particular. Every member of the church should be a worker. Preach, Maxwell. And they must work according to their ability and the opportunities that they have. For the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 12, 4 through 5, "For even as we have members in one body, and all the members have not the same office, so we who are many are one body in Christ and severally members of one another." And so he, in the church that God wants, elders are called bishops, which means that they are overseers. Is that right? They oversee. Sometimes they're called pastors, which means that they are shepherds and they are have been charged with feeding. Acts 20 and verse 28. However, the most commonly referred to in Scripture are elders. In Acts 11 and verse number 30, the Bible says relief was sent to Judea. This they did and sent it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul. In Acts chapter 14 and verse number 23, when Paul and Barnabas had traveled to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, the Bible says, when they had appointed elders in every church and prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed, exhorting them to continue in the faith. Are y'all with me? The word elders comes from a Greek word which means older or senior. But it describes one really who is mature. It speaks more to the individual's life experience and his wisdom. He is wise because he has learned much from living a long time on this earth. Doesn't mean that he has to be 90 years old, but he is to be mature. Amen? Notice a specific age is not given. They should not, however, be a novice. According to 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 6, in other words, they should not have just been baptized, dry off, come out of the baptismal pool, and now are being considered to be an elder of the church because they have gray hair. So they should not be a younger person or a new convert. The office of elders was appointed by God for his church in Acts 13 and verse number 2. The Holy Spirit said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work hereunto I have called them." Paul and Barnabas were selected by the Holy Spirit to go forth to preach God's word where it had not been preached before. And part of their work was to appoint elders in every church, according to Acts 14 and verse number 23. Paul sent Titus to Crete to set things in order that were wanting and appoint elders in every city. Titus 1 and verse number 5. The elders of the church at Ephesus were made overseers by the Holy Spirit when they followed the qualifications he had given. Acts chapter 20 and verse number 28. And from these scriptures that we read, it is clear that the office of elders is God's will for his church. A congregation may not be able to have elders at times. They may not have any men who meet the qualifications. Maybe all the men in the congregation are novices. And when this is the case, the men of the congregation come together under the leadership of the local minister to make decisions for the church. However, it is wrong to appoint unqualified men and designate them as church leaders leaders and give them the authority of the work of elders just to have elders. I'm not even at the good part yet. Additionally, churches of Christ are what we call autonomous in government. Each one is independent of all others. Does that make sense? Each one has his own leadership. We read in the New Testament of churches in an area such as the churches of Galatia. However, there was no district organization where there was a district that made up rules for all the other churches. Each of the churches in Galatia was self-governing. It is easy to see that God's plan for his church was for each church in each place to be self-governing, but they are to obey the Lord. When Paul and Barnabas returned from their first missionary journey, they again visited the congregations that they had established, and they appointed for them elders in every church, according to Acts 14 and verse 23. Every church had its own eldership. Amen. And when Paul wrote to the church in Philippi, he addressed his letter to the saints in Christ Jesus there at Philippi with the bishops and the deacons, and the apostle Peter commanded the elders to do what? Tend to the flock which is among you. Not to all the flock in all the city, but to the flock among you. Therefore, the elders of the church at Figueroa don't run down to Crenshaw, bust in the doors telling them this is how we're going to do things over here because this is how we do things down the street. Amen? Now, that does not mean that congregations don't come together and work together with the leadership in order to get things done. Amen? I think we have one of the great things, and I think I've said this about the city of Los Angeles, is that there is a history of congregations working together. It's not like that in every city. You go to some cities, and some congregations don't talk to each other because of stuff that happened in 82 and 72 and 62 and 52. And they're operating on their side of town, and you operating on your side of town, and nary do the twain ever come together and meet. But it shouldn't be like that. But we do need to go on record and say that leadership at one congregation don't tell leadership at another congregation exactly what to do. Now, if there's a problem biblically, then you can meet with them and say, we have a problem, but we're not going to go in and start changing things where you all meet. Does that make sense? In each local church, we read of more than one elder. Paul and Barnabas appointed for them, listen, elders in every church. Never do we read in the New Testament of a church only having one elder. Amen? In order to serve as an elder, a man must have the qualifications that God has given in his word. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, I have a whole sermon on qualifications. And Titus chapter 1, 5 through 9, it is wrong to appoint men to serve as elders who do not meet the qualifications. Whew, you're a tough group this morning. Congregations can cooperate with one another in doing the Lord's work. We have some examples in the New Testament. The church, the Jerusalem church, you remember on one occasion in Acts 11, 22, the Jerusalem church sent Barnabas. They sent Barnabas to help the church that was over in Antioch. The congregation in Antioch sent help to the churches of Judea when they were in need in Acts 11 and 27. Paul received support from other congregations in order to be able to preach the gospel to the church that resided at Corinth. 2 Corinthians 11 and verse number 8. Titus and another brother were chosen by the churches to take up. You remember that contribution that was taken up for the churches, the needy churches in Macedonia and Achaia to Jerusalem. These churches cooperated with each other to do the Lord's work. However, they did not form a separate organization apart from the local church. There was no city, no province, no state or regional organization that told all the other churches what to do. In denominationalism, you have districts. And there's a head over the district, and they vote on that person. That person over that district runs things in that district. They have district meetings, and they tell the churches in those districts what to do, how to do it, and when they're going to do it. But we have our instructions from the Word of God. Amen? The Church of Christ has no headquarters other than heaven. And we look to heaven as our guide to get our marching orders to carry out our work on earth. Amen, somebody. God's wisdom is seen in the way he has organized his church. When we step back and take a look at the church, we can see the wisdom of God leaping off the pages of inspiration. Aren't you glad that when it comes to the organization of the church, we can know what God wants and not have to make up what we think God wants, but we can go to the book and see what God wants. And when we know what God wants, we ought to give God what he wants. Now. God's wisdom is seen in the way he has organized the church. Now watch this. If a window is made up of a single pane of glass, just one stone hitting the glass will break the whole window. If the window is made up of several panes of glass, a stone that hits one pane will break only that pane. Am I right about it? The same is true of God's church. If there is a central earthly organization of all the churches and false teachers come in, am I right about it? All the other churches will naturally be led astray because they're being ruled by one. If there is no central earthly organization, then false teachers might lead one congregation astray. But heavens to Betsy, it won't lead all of them astray. Is that right? And that's why you hear, that church has gone left. That church is not, but that doesn't mean that because that church went that way, that the Figueroa church has to go that way. Why? Because that church does not run things for the whole city. Our headquarters are in heaven. And people of the book need to stick to the book. Well, God's way is the best I've come to know. And the church belongs to the Lord. Isn't that right? Why, preacher? Because he purchased it with his own blood. We have a blood shed in God. Am I right about it? Often men are not happy with the way God has organized his church. And they think that they can improve upon that which is already perfect. We don't have the right to change what God has already done. Galatians 1, 6 and 9, and Revelation 22 and 18 tell us don't be changing stuff. Am I right about it? And if they change the organization, if you change the name, if you change the worship or the work of the church, it ceases to be the church that Jesus Christ built. It's a church, but it's not the one Jesus built. And so we need to be content to do the things that God has told us to do, knowing that that ought to be enough. Let us call things Figueroa, Bible things by Bible names. Let us, and you've heard this, do Bible things Bible ways. And when we do this, we can be sure that we're pleasing the Lord. And if those who know don't study the scriptures, and if we assume that people come in the church already knowing and just pick up this teaching by osmosis, then we are in danger of adopting, are you with me? Our own set of rules along with God's. Isn't it a delight to come to the house of God and have freedom to search the scriptures together to know what God wants? Now that we know about the organization and the autonomy, I want to spend a minute talking about some characteristics that we know God wants leadership. And we know God wants, he has indicated that the leadership should be placed in the hands of faithful men. Not unfaithful, but faithful. But he doesn't just want a man. He doesn't want just any man. Sisters, here's your opportunity. He wants a God-fearing, faithful man. Am I right about it? A man that meets the qualifications that God has set. And not just a man looking good in a suit. He looks like an elder. He looks like a preacher. But not just any man. He wants a specific kind of man. There must always be more than one man serving as an elder. We look at the organization and we look at the autonomy, how the church is governed. We look at the organization, how the leadership of the church works. But I want to spend some time on the type of leadership that is conducive to growth, because once we cross all the T's and once we dot the I's, we have to know how to get along in the church. Can I spend some time on this? He wants servants with a servant's heart, with a mind for the people. Because you can have uniformity and don't have a unity. We can take communion every first day of the week, not sing with instruments of music and brag about that, assemble on the right day and say the right words and still be dead while we liveth. Fussing and fighting, going out different doors, all in the name of uniformity, but not be able to progress and go ahead because we have not developed the character on the inside of a servant's heart that God wants, along with qualifications. So let's look at some attitude of leadership. And this is what I'm going to share right now. This is going to keep us right here. This is going to keep us from sabotaging our own success. You don't hear a lot about this in the church, but I suspect that while we have gotten the doctrine right, we haven't dealt a lot with the people of the doctrine. We created some little robots who can quote the plan of salvation, but don't have a personal plan for success that starts with the spiritual and then shows up into the areas that reach out in all aspects of our life. There are some principles in leadership, amen, that if they're not employed, will stop you and this church as a whole from going forward while God is reaching down. We need to be reaching up. And God won't send us to a level that we refuse to go ourselves. Amen. You remember when Jesus came walking to his disciples on the sea? You remember that? Immediately he made his disciples get in a boat and he sent them out. And he was going to join them later. And they got in that boat and they went before him to the other side. And they were going over to Bethsaida. And while he dismissed the crowd, after he had taken leave of them, he went up on a mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out in the sea. You remember that story? And he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was contrary to them. And about the fourth watch of the night, which is the darkest part of the night, am I right about it? He came walking to them on the water. Now, I don't know about you, that may not seem scary to you, but it's scary to me to see a figure in a boat at night, at the darkest part of the night, walking on the water. And his disciples cried out, on the sea, for they all saw him, and they were what? Terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, take heart, Mark 6:45, take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. But sometimes we miss the fact that the text said he would have passed. He walked on the water and he would have passed them by. And he set his face and steered his course as if he would have gone further. Am I right about it? Even though he saw them in distress and took no notice of them, this he did to awaken them to call out to him. In other words, this means that Jesus wanted to help them, but they had to first call out to him, letting them know that they needed him. Am I right about it? And they needed the master of the sea to help calm the sea. So divine disposition does not rule out human action. In other words, God will not take you to the next level if you refuse to go. It's going to apply to leadership here. There are some irrational beliefs that will stop leaders and members in general from going up. Y'all ready for this? This is not about money. This is not about prestige. This is about progress. Because it's a shame to live long and not have progress. Help me, somebody. I want to have some progress. I don't want to have lived 50 years, Wilfred, and not have made any progress. So this is not only going to help those who want to be leaders, it's going to help every member in the pew with personal leadership. It's going to help you on your job, and this is for free. There are six irrational belief patterns that hinder progress. And the first one is that I'm undeserving. I cannot see myself in this position. This often comes from what people have said to you or about you at some point in your life. They have programmed you to see yourself in a limited parameter. You can't be that. You can't do that. Have you ever thought about being a teacher? Because you may not be able to be a doctor. So when you see opportunities beyond what you've been programmed, you will reject them because you don't see yourself capable of doing the task, even though you've been blessed with the talent, the mind power as well to achieve it. You will not go any further because you feel that you can't do it because of what somebody said. That's number one. Number two is, the second one is ordinary. I don't want to stand apart and be different than the crowd. I want to be ordinary and blend in so that nobody notices that I'm even here. And if nobody notices me, then they can't pick on me. You'd be surprised at the number of people who hold on to this belief system that holds on to being ordinary, and they will not take the lead. I'm afraid that if I step out and present myself, I will become a target. And guess what? You will. You will be a target. Amen? Is that right, church? If you take the lead, you will automatically become a target. But just because they're shooting at you doesn't mean they shot you. Amen? In fact, someone ought to shout at the fact that someone who has opposed you has emptied out their basket of arrows shooting at you, and you're still standing, and the person who wouldn't do what you're doing for fear of being shot at doesn't realize that because of your faith and your convictions, you've been able to pass through the arrows that have been shot at you, and God still has you standing. Anybody ever been shot at because you took the lead, stepped out front, and said, I will identify myself, and here come the arrow. Well, you're ducking and dodging. Say, I didn't know all this was in leadership. You got to know this ahead of time. Is that right? You will become a target. But that's all right. You serve a good God. And you have to have the courage to do what you have to do, to be able to see the arrows flying past you, the criticism that is hurled your way, and be able to stand like Job and say, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Was that the second one? You ready for the third one? The third belief pattern that may be hindering you from going forward and progress is social change. It's the fear of rejection or loneliness, or claims that you have changed or now have sold out. I don't want to be rejected by my environment, so I go with the flow in order to fit in. Is that right? And you know, the idea that we have to stick together, you got to watch out for the we. We got to stick together. Watch out for the we's, because people will control you with the we. You know, we do this and we do that. Who is we? Because that's the crowd. Am I right about it? You may miss your opportunity at doing what's best for you, trying to be loyal to the we. You get in trouble, and the we is what? It's gone. We teach our children about peer pressure. And in order to fit in, you pass up the promotion. You pass by moving out of the neighborhood that you were defined by. You pass up the position that you wanted to take because your friends won't like what you've done. And now you step out from your friends in order to lead, and you had to leave the we. It's the fear of social rejection. Oh, I see who you are now. Now you can't talk to us, and you've changed. It's not the you that's changed. It's the we. That's changed. Be careful of the we. All right? Now, trying to fit in. This is for the young folk here. And you have some friends. Some of you remember being in school. And you know how girls will hang out in a pack. And they'll run together. And so in order to fit in, you stay with everybody else. And you don't launch out and lead, because if you do, you may be ostracized by the crowd, who says, now you think you're somebody because you can't hang with us no more. That's not true. And all because you want to be sitting beside the crowd. Now, somebody ought to give me this CD myself. I listen to this when I get back home, let it marinate some more. The fourth belief pattern that may be hindering you from going forward in terms of leadership is the idea that it won't last. It's fleeting. That my success is only temporary and temporal. And I will not, watch this, be able to sustain what they say I can do. Are y'all with me? That at some point I won't be able to keep up doing what they say I can do. And what I'm doing now, I don't see myself doing long term. It's only fleeting, and it's going to run away from me. You're afraid that it won't last, and you have short term success in relationships, on a particular job. It didn't last. Therefore, you believe that all that comes after that won't last either. And nothing else is going to happen exciting in your life, and nothing noteworthy will ever happen to you again. And as I go through these belief systems, I want you to look for the ones that sound like you. Amen. Amen. There's somebody in here saying, that's me, and check that off the list. And I don't want to sign up for this because I don't think I can continue it past 3 months. And if I become a leader, if I start teaching this class, I know I won't be able to teach it long, because I can't stay nowhere more than 6 months. It won't last. That's going to hinder you from going forward. The fifth belief pattern that may be hindering you is the idea of perfectionism. I will have to behave as if I'm perfect, and I know deep down inside I'm not. Well, join the rest of us. Amen? Because nobody in here is perfect. Is that right? Now, the Bible said, Jesus, be you perfect as I am perfect. He's talking about being mature. He's talking about being teleos, being grown up, having some wisdom, but not perfect in the instance that you will never make a mistake, because none of us in here can say, I am perfect. And so the idea of perfectionism, if you hold on to that, you will not progress as you could progress, because you're afraid of making a mistake or someone seeing you as less than you already know you are. Watch this. In Luke 5, in verse number 8, when you remember Peter, this was Peter's problem. Peter saw the power of God. And when you see the power of God and you compare yourself, you know how unfit you are. And he saw the power of God to bless him. He recognized the power of God to destroy him. He said in Luke 5 and verse 8, he said what? Depart from me, Jesus. Why? Because I know I have too many imperfections. He fell on his knees before Jesus saying what? Depart from me. I don't want to get in the light because somebody might see my imperfections. So I'm going to stay what? Secretly talented. I'm going to disguise that I've been blessed. I don't want folk, no, I'm just going to resign to sing in the shower. I'm going to preach in the closet. Come on, somebody. I'm not going to go to the church and display my talent because I know that you know, I'm just going to stay at home. I'm going to leave the church and say what they ought to do and what somebody ought to say, what somebody ought to write a book about. I'm going to lock up my treasure inside of me, hoping that everybody else will release theirs because I'm imprisoned by my imperfections. And I don't want anyone to know that I'm not perfect, even though I'm good at this. And I'm talented at this. But I know that I'm weak in that area. And when I step out to lead or do something, folk are going to know that I don't have it all together. Amen. And so Peter said, look, I refuse to accept this blessing because I'm a sinful man. I know something about myself that I don't want everybody else to know. Amen. And I'm concerned about the security of people who perceive me to be one way than I know who I really am. Is this making sense? So I'll pass the progress and to keep my status quo, because I like what they think about me there at that church. And if I step out to lead and I do it long enough, folk gonna know I don't always make the right decision and I don't always say the right thing. But we have to understand that's why we have Jesus. That's why we have the Holy Spirit. That's why we have the forgiveness, the blood of Christ, to forgive our sins, because we are faulty and frail individuals. Amen? And as soon as we understand this, that even from the pulpit down to the pew, we're all trying to get to heaven. You'd be surprised how difficult it is sometimes to preach to God's people. Amen? That we don't roll out of, preachers and leaders don't roll out of the bed with a sermon on their mouth and a Bible class in their back pocket. Is that right? And when you stand up to lead, you're exposing yourself to the group to say what? Even though I share God's word with you, I have to understand that at my core, I still have some things I need to work on. Amen, somebody. But we're in this thing together. Somebody please say amen right about now. We're in this thing together, and we're trying to make heaven our home. I help you so that you can in turn help me, and then we help each other, and as a result, we all go up. Newsflash, everybody's got some issues. Hello? Does this side have some issues? Don't make me come down there. Does this side have some issues? Does this side have some issues? Does this side have some issues? Well, since we're all in agreement, feet too, since we all have some issues, then we can be real with one another. Amen? And if I'm not having a good day, I don't have to say I'm having a good day. Amen? And I don't have to be rude. Sometimes I can just say, ah. How you doing, Brother Matt? I'm here. It's going to be all right. Is that right? If I'm not having a good day, I don't have to say it's good. I don't have to be all right all the time. Is that right? And that's one of the things that people who step up to take the lead say, I always got to be on. I've always got to be batting 1,000. I've always got to be having a great day and one of the greatest days of my life. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes you're only batting 250. Is that right? Sometimes you just struck out before you walk through the church house doors. But I've got to know somewhere that it's going to be all right because I serve a perfect God. And so, if you're out there and you don't think I'm talking to you, you have an issue of denial. When we pick our leaders, we usually want people who don't have any issues. This is unrealistic. It's unreal because we have issues. But usually when we look to pick leaders, we want folk who look like at least they don't have any issues. Child, they're just as messed up as I am. How are they going to lead me? They may have a good understanding of how to lead you because they've been through it. Amen? We walk around I don't know if I ought to say that. We got issues. We got a designer bag full of issues, a backpack full of issues, suitcases rolling in, roller bag full of issues, but we don't want our leaders to have none. Him? An elder? Him? A deacon? I went to school with him. That's been 35 years ago. Have you seen the way they walk? They look mad all the time. They walk funny. Did God say, look at the way they walk? Did he say, look at the expression on their face? Huh? Whew. Let me get to the sixth one. The sixth belief pattern, and here's where a lot of us hang out, is I'll be too bombarded by people who want things from me. It's too much that goes with this. And I'll have to do the things that I don't want to do sometime. I'll have to give up my leisure time. And child, Saturdays are mine. And I can't hang out like I used to because of all the responsibility that will befall me. Are y'all with me? And you start strange things to prove to people that you're still the same person because people will put pressure on you to stay low as you begin to go up. All right? And there are many people who associate with you because of who you are, all right? Of where you are, rather than who you are. And you begin to attract a whole different group of people who didn't pay you any attention before because of now where you are, but have bypassed who you are. Does that make sense? People will start fighting over your success when they think you have a little something, and then they begin to say that you have changed. Talk to anybody who's gone up in sports or in entertainment. If you talk to them and they have gone up, the first thing that people say is, you have changed, right? But really, it's the people around them that do the most changing. Watch how the conversation changes. Normally, they would be having a conversation with you about something, but now you begin to have all this pressure as you have been identified by some as a leader, and it's something like, and especially with those who have gone from becoming automatically wealthy, the conversation changes around them. And you start having a regular, normal conversation, and all of a sudden, when people know that you have something, the conversation changes, and all of a sudden I'm really going through it. My rent is like 3 months behind. And I know it's not a problem for somebody like you. You got it all, but it's hard out there in them streets. And you know, right now about 2,500 would set me straight. I know that's a lot to us, but it's not a lot to you. And now you have all this pressure. Now you can bring this, that type of attitude in the church. When people begin to lead, there becomes a lot of pressure. They are bombarded with people who want things. And we're here to help people. We understand that. And we're here, but when you lead, you have to step out and deal with it, because it comes with the territory. Is that right? Not only does the target come, but you also have the pressure that comes. But when you're led by the Lord, you can handle it, because you recognize it's not all your responsibility to change people. We're trying to help people. Now, the fear to manage these fears, the fear to manage these six fears, create what we call a self-sabotaging, self-handicapping situations where you are incapable of moving forward. And you know what it does? It will make you, if you're not careful, a chronic underachiever. God says, I know the plans I have for you. And the plans that God has are plans for success and not failure. But if you don't give yourself permission to lead, you'll cancel out your opportunity, not because of external conflict, but because of internal conflict, just dealing with yourself. Now, you cannot lead and not have external conflict. If you're a follower, then this may not apply to you, because the leader will always clear the path for you, and you won't have to worry about it. And the follower can step in the path of the leader and say, you know, this is really nice. But the leader has done what? Forged the path. Now, if you want to be a follower, this may not help you. But if you have personal leadership and you want to advance in life, in home, on the job, and even in the church, you have to recognize that there's going to be some external conflict that's going to come your way. For whenever you do something new or different or innovative, people will always reject it at first. Amen. Because it has never been done before, or very few people ever did it, and sometimes the impact of what you're doing will not be felt until after you're dead. Can I preach a little while? So if your need to be accepted becomes more powerful than your need to do something in your heart, you understand to be beneficial in the long run, you have to backtrack into the safety zone. You cannot deal with external conflict in a controlled way in which you don't fall apart or go hysterical or lose it or flip out. Do you remember reading about how calm Jesus was when he learned that Lazarus died? And everybody was going, and they were weeping and mourning, and they were losing it, and Jesus was calm, and Lazarus was his friend. Isn't that right? And the reason he was calm is that Jesus was called to fix what others were hysterical about. And if you believe that you can fix it, then why do you need to scream? Is that all right? Boxers will tell you that you'll lose the fight if you get too upset. You may be the most talented fighter in the ring, but you'll lose that fight if somebody makes you upset or gets you angry and you act outside of the game plan you went in the ring with. You can find yourself getting knocked out and laying on the floor, even though you were the better boxer, but you got too upset. And you forgot. You forgot to duck. You can be a leader without being the leader. Say that again, Maxwell. You can be a leader without having to be the leader. Amen? You can lead, this is good. You can lead within your competence. You want to be challenged, yes. Watch this. And you want to be stretched, yes. But you don't want to pop. Sometimes you can lead beyond your competence level to lead. Amen? Because somebody said, you be good for that, and you know deep down in your heart, really, I'm only comfortable at this level, and somebody's trying to say, you need to go for that level, but inside you say, if I go to that level, that's going to stretch me too wide, and I'll pop. And you don't want to pop. Is that right? So if you're not comfortable reading scripture, you want to read scripture, you can work to be able to read scripture. Is that right? But some people say, you know, let me lead in another way. Let me serve the communion and let you read the scripture. And we understand, why? Why can't you read? Yeah, I can read. Matter of fact, I got an A in reading. I can do all of that, but it's something about it makes me uncomfortable, it makes me nervous, and I'm only reading the scripture because you own me so much. You can cause that person, stretch them too wide, and then they pop. Is that right? And really it causes them more of a detriment than it is to help them, because deep down they really knew, I never wanted to read scripture in the first place, but you called me so much and you begged me so much, I just said okay to get you off my back. And you know what? It won't last. It won't last. Can I move on? You have to know your limitations, Figueroa, and your breaking points. All of them are important in leadership. For 360-degree leadership is different than 90-degree leadership. And if you're in a position of minister or elder, let's say your vision needs to be 360. Is that right, Damon? 360 degrees? 360 what? Degrees. Be able to see the whole picture. Amen. And the 90-degree leadership is concerned about rather maybe a particular department. 360 leadership is different than 90-degree leadership. Am I right about it? That's why a person will say, you know, it affected your apartment, your department, and you say, I don't know why they made that decision. You're operating at 90-degree leadership, but the other person may be operating at 360-degree leadership, and what he did or they did that affected you in a certain way may have a benefit for the whole church. Okay? I don't know why Brother Hawkins did that. I don't know why, Brother Maxwell. I don't know why those elders did that. And one of the reasons is that they are looking at things from a different angle that affect more than you. Amen? It affected you one way, but it has a benefit overall for the good for the whole church. Amen? Say amen when you can. When you're in charge of the whole vision, you have to make decisions that affect more than just a ladies' program or a men's program or one of the departments in the educational department, a primary department, or this class or that class. It affects everything in the church. The 360 leader. The danger in 360 leadership is to stop what you're doing in order to come down to 90-degree leadership. Because you're looking at the whole vision, but if you step down from the whole vision in order to run the part of the vision, it's going to mess up the church. Are y'all with me? That's like me going out to go down to teach the primary department. Are y'all with me? I'm not talking about one class, so I got to get down there. I'm going to stop doing this so I can go down because I want to teach the two-year-olds. And I didn't like what the teacher was teaching the two-year-olds, so I'm going to go down and I'm going to teach the two-year-old class. So, Brother Maxwell, you don't, why are you doing that? Well, I want them to learn a certain way, and I'm the only one that can teach the two-year-olds how to understand this concept. Are y'all with me? Huh? And we have to be leader enough. Can I say this? That just because somebody disagrees with you, this is for all leaders, doesn't mean that they're against you. Amen? And leaders have to be strong enough to know that just because the person said I didn't agree with me, doesn't mean that they're against me. And sometimes when someone has another idea and it doesn't jive with ours, we turn that person off and rarely speak to them because they disagreed with the way we wanted to do something. This is going to help us in the long run. Amen? It's going to help us. And there's a way to say some things and still be respectful. And there's a way to do some things and still be on the same team. And you have to be leader enough not to dislike the person that disagreed with you. The disagreement does not mean betrayal. In Luke chapter 17, and I'm closing, verse 1, he said unto his disciples, it is impossible that offenses will not come. The text said will come, but he's basically saying that it's impossible for you to get through this Christian journey and not have any problems. It's impossible to get from here to heaven and never be offended. Amen? It's impossible to get from here to heaven and never have your feelings hurt. Jesus said that. And if we look at Proverbs 18 and 19, the Bible says that a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. And their contentions are like the bars of a castle. Are y'all with me? You have to get used to having controversy, because you'll find it at every level you go to. And God, what God is doing with controversy is like preheating the oven, getting you ready for the furnace of affliction. Now I'm closing number two. That means I'm really closing now. I remember hearing a story of a preacher who had talked with, you all know Andy Young, the civil rights leader, Andy Young. And the younger preacher was talking about how hard the times are. Boy, the times are so difficult. Ooh, it's just so hard these days. There's so many thorns and things, and you have to get through society. It's so cold and callous, and the criticism you have to deal with. It's a perplexing time for leadership now. And Dr. Young said, oh, that's nothing new. If you ever heard Eddie Young talk, he said, oh, that's nothing new. He said, Dr. King, they were fighting him on every side. He was put out by the next Dr. Kings that were trying to supplant him. Y'all with me? And the very ones trying to put him out, they were fighting him. He said they were fighting him internally. They were fighting him externally. We're not talking about them bugging his house. We're not talking about that. We're talking about from his own group, internally and externally, as in addition to, they were bugging his house. And then he said, some kind of way, we managed to make progress. He said, I don't know how we did it, for there was murmuring on the inside, murmuring on the outside. There was complaining and bickering all around us. We didn't agree even among ourselves in the civil rights movement, let alone those that were really out there opposing us. He said we could not wait for the controversy to stop in order for the movement to go forward. And don't you know, we can't stop the work in the church when little things arise. We have to keep on. Can you say it with me? Keeping on. We have to keep on keeping on. At every level, even in controversy, even in affliction, we cannot stop because Jesus didn't stop. And surely we know that Jesus was the great leader. I talked about Dr. King, but I want to talk about Jesus, the King. Watch Jesus when he says to his disciples, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Now here comes the controversy. Jesus, you so controversial that some say you're what? Some say you're what? John the Baptist? You're so controversial, Jesus, there is not even an agreement on who people say you are. Some say you're what? John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're one of the prophets. Thou art Jeremiah. Some say that you're one of the prophets. You're so controversial that even your enemies are not even in agreement. And then he says to his followers, Who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? Now, before I quote what Peter said, it's not Peter's statement that amazes me. It's the silence of the 11. Woo, give me this tape. 11 disciples said nothing. Didn't he, who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? And 11 said nothing. So often when you're leading people who don't even know who you are. And if you can get out one out of 12, you might be doing pretty good. If one guy will speak up for you, you're doing pretty good. And Peter, thank God for big mouth Peter. When Peter said what? I know who you are. Thou art the Christ, the Son of what? Of the living God. Most people who benefit from your leadership sometimes don't even have a clue who you are because they don't understand what they have, but we know what we have. We have Jesus. Am I right? The greatest leader that this world has ever known. He wants to lead you. And the Jesus that I know is a mighty good leader. The Lord is my light. And he stepped out absolutely on nothing and hurled the words from his mouth. Let there be light. Guess what happened? Just because he said it, there was light. And before there was a group to sing, and before there was a song leader to lead singing, isn't that right? Before there was a gospel record ever cut or produced, before anybody ever said amen, the Lord praised himself. And he said, it was good. Isn't that right? As a matter of fact, before there was ever a man or a woman to praise God, God stepped back and praised himself. Look at the leadership of our leader. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was what? And the Word was with God. And the Word what? And the Word was God. He was with God. Listen to where the Word was. The Word was with God. Where? In the beginning. And through him, all things were made. And without him, nothing was made that has been made. In verse number 4 said, in him was life, and the life was the light of man. And guess what that light did, church? The light shined in darkness. Y'all see where I'm going? But the darkness didn't know what it was, comprehended it not. Jesus is the true light that gives light to every man. Oh, I got so much in here, but I'm going to have to let it go. But he is the light, and he will guide you. And when the light hits something, the darkness does what? It runs away. Let me bring that home. Sometimes we have dark thoughts. And at times, we have dark feelings. Isn't that right? At times, our attitude becomes dark. And sometimes, we make dark choices. But what we ought to do is shine God's light and leadership on those dark things in our life. And his light, if we stay in it, will run the darkness away. Stand on your feet. We're going to pray right now. Somebody is out in the world, and they need to come into the light. Well, it's sunshining out there, Brother Mac. It's still dark. And God wants to shine his light on your life. And we're here today as friends to tell you to come out of the darkness and run into his marvelous light. Place yourself under his leadership. Obey his word. If you're outside of Christ, you need to be baptized for the remission of your sins. Let his blood cleanse you. Let the Holy Spirit that he gives guide you. And walk in the light as he is what?
In the light.
In the light. His blood will cleanse you. It's in continuous operation, not only at the baptismal pool, but all throughout your life. If you're here and you recognize, I need to make some changes. I've come to the end of 2016. And at the end of the year is no better than it was at the beginning. I had all year to work on some things. And I had my backpack, my roller bag full of problems, and I carried them with me all the way through to December. What day is it? 18th. And I still have them. I need to do something with this load I'm carrying. And we're asking you today to drop it at the feet of Jesus. And after we pray for you, don't pick it up and take it back to your seat and take it home. Leave it right here. And watch how the Lord will progress your life. And you'll keep going up and up and up. How many of you want to go up higher than where you are? Well, I'm already up, preacher. You can go higher than where you are. Don't put a cap. Don't put a limit on how you can progress. This lesson has affected you in some way where you know you need to make some changes. You need to come on right now. Come on right now while together we're standing and singing the song of invitation.
Have thine own way.
Come on, come on.